Hello, good morning everybody. Now today's lecture on the embryology, that is the development of phase. In the last lecture, we have seen the development of the thyroid gland and its anabolism. Now we are going to see the development of phase. Now the development of phase occurs during the fourth week of intermittent life. After the formation of the head fold, two prominent bulgings appear on the ventral aspect of developing embryo separated by the stomodium. The first bulging, that is the developing brain cranially, and there is a pericardium caudally. While the floor of the stomodium is formed by the buccopharyngeal membrane, we separate it from the foregut. Now, on its side, the stomodium is bounded by the first arch, that is the mandibular arch. Okay, the stomodium, which is the gap between the two bulgings, that is the cranial, there is a developing brain, and caudal, there is a pericardium. While the floor is formed by the buccopharyngeal membrane, and on its side, it is bounded by the mandibular or the first arch. Now, this diagram is showing this is the forebrain bulging above, that is cranially. Caudal, there is a bulging of the pericardium. This is the floor, which is formed by the buccopharyngeal membrane. And on its side of the stomodium, there is a first arch or the stomodium. Okay, these are the two bulgings and one floor, that is the buccopharyngeal, which is formed by the buccopharyngeal membrane, and on its side by the we get the mandibular arch. Now the mesoderm of the forebrain bulging, which proliferate to form a frontonasal process. This is the frontonasal process. This is the stomodium and this is floor. This is the pericardium. Now next. Soon, mesoderm covering the developing forebrain proliferates and form a downward projection that overlaps the upper part of the stomodium. This downward projection is known as frontonasal process. Then pharyngeal arches are laid down in the lateral and ventral wall of the most cranial part of the foregut. These are also therefore in very close relation to the stomodium. Now this diagram showing this. This is the frontonasal process. This is pericardial bulging. This is the first arch, that is the mandibular arch. And this is stomodium. Stomodium. And this is the maxillary process, which arises from the mandibular arch. The neck region, this is neck region elongated by the appearance of the various pharyngeal arches. Now, the face is derived from the structure that lie around the stomodium. First, we get the unpaired frontonasal process above, from above. Then we get a pair first pharyngeal or mandibular arch of each side. Each mandibular arch form the lateral wall of the stomodium. This mandibular arch form the lateral wall of the stomodium. This arch gives off a bud from its dorsal end, and this bud is called as maxillary process. Then the mandibular arch grows ventromedially cranial to the main part of this arch, which is now called as mandibular process. The remaining mandibular arch is also, it is known as mandibular process. this one bud arises from the mandibular process is known as maxillary process. Okay, then the face derived from the these various processes, that is the one pair, that is frontonasal process from above. Then we get the pair of the first pharyngeal arch, that is mandibular arch of each side. Each mandibular arch from the lateral wall of the stomodium. And this arch gives off a bud from its dorsal end, that is known as maxillary process. Then the mandibular process or the arch grows ventromedially, cranial to the main part of the arch, that is known as mandibular process. Now the five primordia for the development, for the face development. We get frontonasal process, a pair of the maxillary process, and a pair of the mandible process. There are five primordia for development of the face. Then each process consists of a core of the mesenchyme and is covered by the surface ectoderm. Each process consists of core part, that is the mesoderm, that is mesenchyme cells, and it is covered with the surface ectoderm. At about the fourth week, the stomodium is bounded on the cephalic side by the bulging of the four brain vesicles and caudal by the ventral ends of the mandibular arches. Now this is the frontonasal process. This is pericardium, and these are two mandibular. This is the mandibular arch, and this part is the stomodium, primitive mouth. Now from the mandibular arch we get the one process arises from that. That is the maxillary process, which grow cranially and medially. Then the remaining mandible process, which grows medially and slightly upward, that is known as mandibular process. And this is pericardium. Now this primitive mouth or stomodium, it is bounded by the above by the frontonasal process, below by the pericardium. On a side there is a maxillary and mandibular process. Now the ectoderm overlying the frontonasal process soon shows the bilateral localized thickenings that are situated a little above the stomodium on either side of the midline. These thickenings are known as nasal flacos. These thickenings are known as nasal flacos. The formation of this flacot is induced by the underlying forebrain. Now these flacos soon sink below the surface to form a nasal pits. These flacos soon sink below the surface to form a nasal pits. The pits are continuous with the stomodium below. The edges of each nasal pits are raised above the surface. Then we get the medial raised edge is called medial nasal process, and lateral raised edge is known as lateral nasal process. Now then this nasal pits, it is bounded medial, there is a medial nasal process which is raised margin, and lateral there is a lateral nasal process. Okay. These are the nasal flacos, which is formed by the thickening of the ectoderm cells, which then sink and that form a, then it becomes nasal pits, which is continuous with the primitive mouth or the stomodium. Because of sinking, there are two elevated margins. One is medial elevated edge, and this is lateral. Medial elevated ridge is known as mandibular process, medial nasal process, and the lateral elevated ridge is known as lateral nasal process. These are the maxillary process. This is the mandibular process. This fuse. This is primitive stomodium. This is the side view of the developing phase. This is the again front of the nasal process. This is pericardium. Let's go to pericardium. These are the arches. This is the first mandibular arch. And the process from that, there is maxillary process. This is nasal pits, which get sink and divide these two elevated margin. One is medial and one is lateral. These are various arches. Now the development of the various part of the face. Now development of various part of face. First, lower lip. The mandibular process of the two sides grow towards each other and fuse in midline. The fused mandibular process gives rise to lower lip and the lower jaw. This lower lip derived from the mandible process. Two mandible process of to grow to each other and fuse in midline, and the fused mandible process gives rise to the lower lip and lower jaw. Now the upper lip is formed by the maxillary process. Each maxillary process now grows medially below the developing eye and fuses first with the lateral nasal process, then with the medial nasal process. Here the medial and the lateral nasal process, they also fuse to each other. Okay, this upper lip, how it is formed by the maxillary process, they grow medially and fuse with the lateral nasal process, then with the medial nasal process. And the medial and the lateral nasal process, they also fuse to each other. In this way, the nasal pits, now called as external hairs, are cut from the stomodium. The maxillary process undergo the considerable growth. At the same time, the frontonasal process becomes much narrower from side to side, with the result that the two external hairs clump closer together. Because of the growth of the maxillary process, the frontonasal process becomes narrow and the two external hairs come closer together. Now this is the frontonasal process. This is medial nasal process. This is lateral nasal process. This is nasal pits. First, this is the frontonasal process, very broad initially. Now this is the maxillary process, which grows medially, and first it fuses with the medial nasal process. It fused with the lateral nasal process, then with the medial nasal process, and this lateral and medial process, they also fuse together at the nasal pits, then separate from the primitive mouth. This primitive mouth, this is the nasal pits, these are processes, medial nasal process, lateral nasal process. This is maxillary process, which grows medially, fused with the lateral nasal process, then medial nasal process, and these two, there's a medial and lateral nasal process also fused to each other. This frontonasal process, it become the narrower. same diagram again. This is broadly frontonasal process. This is the medial nasal process. This is the lateral one. This is the nasal process which goes medially, fusing with the lateral nasal process and with the lateral medial nasal process. This medial lateral nasal process also fuse to each other, and this nasal pits get separated from the primitive mouth. It is cut off from the primitive mouth. Because of the growth of the maxillary process medially, this frontonasal process becomes narrow. Now the upper lip is derived as follows. Mesodermal basis of the lateral part of the upper lip is formed by the maxillary process. Mesodermal basis of the lateral part of the lip is derived from the maxillary process, and mesodermal basis of the median part of the upper lip, that is known as philtrum, depressed area, it is formed by the frontonasal process. Okay, this lateral part mesodermal basis of the lateral part of the upper lip is formed by the maxillary process, while the mesodermal basis of the median part of the lip, that is derived or that is formed by the frontonasal process. This is the mesodermal basis of the upper lip. Okay. Then ectoderm of the maxillary process overgrows to meet that of the opposite maxillary process in midline. As a result, the skin of the entire upper lip is innervated by the maxillary nerve. The skin of the lateral part and the middle part is derived from the maxillary process, while the mesodermal part derived, that is the lateral part of the, that is mesodermal basis of the lateral part derived from the maxillary process, or the mesodermal basis of the medial part is derived from the frontonasal process. But the skin of the upper lip, which is derived from the ectoderm of maxillary process. This ectoderm overgrows to meet that of the opposite maxillary process in the midline. That's why, as a result, the skin of the entire upper lip is innervated by the maxillary process. That's why the skin is supplied by the maxillary nerve. Now, this is the upper part. This diagram showing the upper part of the upper lip. This is the lateral part. And this is median part. Now the mesodermal basis of the lateral part is derived from the maxillary process, and the mesodermal basis of the median part, where it forms a philtrum, that is derived from the frontonasal process. Now skin, that is ectoderm of the maxillary process, which overgrows and meet with the ectoderm of the opposite maxillary process and fuse in the midline. That's why the skin is derived from the maxillary process, while the mesodermal basis of the lateral part is derived from the maxillary process, while the medial part of the mesodermal basis is derived from the frontonasal process. The development of cheek. After formation of the upper and lower lips, the stomodium, that is primitive mouth, is very broad. In its lateral part, it is bounded above by the maxillary process and below by the mandibular process. Now this process undergo the progressive fusion with each other to form the cheeks. The maxillary process fuses with the lateral nasal process. And this fusion is not only occurs in the region of the lip, but also extend from the stomatodium to the medial angle of the developing artery. For some time, this line of fusion is marked by the groove, marked by a groove that is called a mesooptic furrow. It is known as mesooptic furrow or nasolacrimal sulcus. It is also known as nasolacrimal sulcus. The strip of ectoderm becomes buried along this furrow and gives rise to nasolacrimal duct. That's why nasolacrimal duct is ectoderm in origin. Now the development of in short, the lateral and cranial to the nasal flaccus, a pair of thickenings, that is ectodermal thickenings, appear and they are called as lens flaccus. The lens flaccus is present on the ventrolateral side of developing forebrain. The lens flaccus sinks below the surface and is eventually cut off from the surface ectoderm. Now, developing eyeball produces a bulging. The bulgings of the eyes are at first directed laterally and lie in the angle between the maxillary process and the lateral nasal process. With the narrowing of the frontal nasal process, they come to face forwards. Now, the eyelids are derived from the folds of the ectoderm that are formed above and below the eyes and by the mesodermal enclosed within the folds. They are mesodermal in origin. Eyelids are mesodermal in origin. Now, development of nose. Nose receive the contribution from the frontal nasal process and from the medial and lateral nasal process of the right and left side. Now, external nerves are formed when the nasal pits are cut off from the stomodium by the fusion of the maxillary process with the medial nasal process. Now, the external nerves gradually approach each other. This is a result of the fact that the frontal nasal process becomes progressively narrower and its deeper part ultimately forms the nasal septum. The mesoderm becomes heaped up in the median plane to form the prominence of the nose. As the nose becomes prominent, the external nerves come to open downwards instead of forwards. Now, the external form of the nose is thus established with the fusion of five processes as follows. The frontal nasal process from the bridge of the nose, fuse or the merge medial nasal process from the dorsum and the tip of the nose, the lateral nasal process is from the ala of the nose. That's why this bridge of the nose is formed by the frontal nasal process, dorsum and the tip of the nose formed by the fused median nasal process, and the ala of the nose formed by the lateral nasal process. Now, this is the face, completely developed face. The nose, which is derived from the frontal nasal process, is from bridge of the nose. Then tip and the dorsum of nose formed by the fused medial nasal process, while the ala of the nose is formed by the lateral nasal process. Upper lip, which is formed by the maxillary process, lateral part of the lip is formed by the maxillary process, while the medial part is formed by the frontonasal process. While the skin of the upper lip, it is formed by the maxillary process only. This ectoderm of the maxillary process, which overgrows and meet with the ectoderm of the opposite maxillary process in the center. That's why the measurable base of the lateral part is formed by the maxillary process. The measurable basis of the median part, that is philtrum part, is formed by the frontolingual process, while the skin is derived from the only maxillary process. Now the upper and then now the lower lip, which is derived from the mandibular arch or the mandibular process. Now the cheeks, which derived from the upper cheek, derived from the maxillary process, while the lower cheek derived from the mandibular process. Now the eyes and the nose, they are derived from the nose, that is the nostril. It is derived from the, it is nothing but the nasal pits, and this and eyes, they are derived from the lens flare cord. While the upper and the lower eyelid, they are derived from the mesodermal basis. Now this is about the development of face in short. The next lecture we are going to see about the development anomalies of the face and the heart. Thank you.